The topic of this presentation will be the Wannier functions and the polarization and the baryphase calculations. So these are more of the exotic topics, but you'll see they have very nice practical applications, and I will put some emphasis on that. So we'll begin with the Wannier functions, and user of the DFT code, I should admit that it looks to me still after 10 years as a big black box, because you put some information in, you get your results, and even the results are correct, it's really hard to find out what exactly is going on and to find the interpretation of this result. I think this is the biggest challenge for the DFT. So it is possible to do a good calculation, but it's more challenging to find real interpretation of these results. And the Wannier functions are actually helping us with this interpretation. So they help us to understand, for example, the nature of chemical bonding. This is one of the application of Wannier functions. And another application of Wannier function would be to speed up calculations and maybe scale up your calculation to many thousands of atoms. And there are more applications which I don't really know too much, but like DMFT and others. So I'm going to focus on the chemistry in this talk. So first introduce the Wannier function. I'll start with the Bloch functions. So the Bloch function is a very popular description of the wave function in packages such as a WIEN2k that involves periodic solids. So the Bloch function consists of two parts. There's a cell periodic part, UR, and you see it here. This is the cell periodic part. And then in the next cell, so this blue dot is indicator of the next cell or another atom. You can imagine this as a chain. You see this periodic part is repeated. There is also a phase factor that is coming with the Bloch function, and this phase factor depends on the k value. If you are at the gamma point, the k value is zero, so this phase factor is one, so there is no envelope function is practically flat, but if the k is non-zero, you get this envelope function that kind of modulates your Bloch function. And the larger is the k, the stronger is this modulation in space. So as you can see, the Bloch functions are continuous, periodic, they're infinite, as infinite is the solid with the periodical boundary conditions. So the approach to Wannier function is completely different. So they're constructed having in mind a localized basis. So this Wannier function is localized and it's not extended over the space. And they're indexed with the real lattice vector. In this case, zero refers to the home unit cell. If you see one, that refers to the next neighboring unit cell. Two refers to the second neighbor unit cell. And you can imagine that works also in 3D. So you have three indices here. So this will be important for us later when we analyze results of the Wannier function calculations. And previously, researchers thought that these two approaches are totally different. But Wannier in 1937 found a way to marry them together using the following transformation. You can see that there's quite a bit of the gap between the time when Wannier proposed this transformation and when Wannier function became really useful. And the reason for this is that these Bloch functions are not quite unique, in the sense that if you take this Bloch function and you see this green envelope function, you can just shift this green envelope function left or right without changing the period of this function, and nothing is going to change to your description. It is just going to be an additional phase factor in the Bloch function. So this doesn't change any physics, but it makes a lot of problems for the Wannier function. So as you can see, you have the block function and some arbitrary phase factor here, which comes from the eigenvalue solver. It is not important for your eigenvalues. It doesn't change the electron density, nothing, but it introduces problems for the in this formula. So this arbitrary phase factor, if you try to compute the Wannier function, you can get a result like this. And you get a different phase factor, you can get a result like this. So basically you use the same block function, but you always end up with a different Wannier functions. And this is what is referred to the ambiguity or non-uniqueness of the Wannier functions. And this was a major barrier for the application of these Wannier functions in the research. So if you look at this, this is just a very simple expression for a single band N. Naturally, our electronic structure is more complicated. We have multiple bands, and the construction of the Wannier function involves the unitary matrix, which is kind of a complex number here, but this will mix your different bands that are involved in the construction of the Wannier function, and there is also ambiguity about the choice of this unitary matrix, and you again result with a different Wannier functions at the end. So it turns out that it is possible to choose this phase factor or the coefficients of this unitary matrix in such a way that you obtain at the end a Wannier function that is maximally localized in space. Like here, you can play with the different values of the phase factor, so you get something like this. This is already becoming more localized, and finally you get a very localized Wannier function. So by finding this matrix, it is possible to construct Wannier functions that are fully localized in space, and then it's possible to measure this localization of the Wannier function, the so-called spread of the Wannier function, by using this formula, which is simply a standard deviation formula. And here R refers to the position of the Wannier center, so that will be somewhere here. This is the position of the Wannier center, and this position of the Wannier center is evaluated using this position operator shown here. So the calculation of the position of the Wannier center is mathematically a little bit intense. So what we do, we take advantage of the fact that this position operator is related to the delta operator in reciprocal space. So you end up with this matrix element, and this can be then discretized in this form. So where you take an overlap between the self-periodic part of the block function in adjacent k points. And this overlap is computed by the WIEN2k package. And overlap, if you can see, this is just a complex number, so it's e to the power I something. So once you take log of this, this is just a phase at the end. So when you do this integral, you end up with a phase here, and this is the so-called bare phase, which we'll talk in more details when we discuss the electronic polarization. So let me get back to more intuitive pictures, and we'll talk about the initial projections. So there are two different approaches to construction of the Wannier functions. So one approach would involve the atom-centered Wannier function, and we use this if we would like to get more insight into the chemistry and chemical bonds in this structure. And in this case, we have to include bonding states as well as the antibonding states. So the number of bands that are included in the calculation should be equal to the number of the Wannier functions. So if we have, for example, four valence bands, there should be four conduction bands, as an example. There's also another way of constructing the so-called bond-centered Wannier functions, where you include in the process of constructing Wannier functions, only the valence band. So there's no conduction band included. Only occupied states are included here. So in this case, your Wannier functions don't quite give you an intuitive picture of the chemical bonding because they're not positioned at the atoms. They're actually positioned in between of the atoms. However, looking at the position of this Wannier function, you can talk about the charge transfer and the polarization in solids. So this position of the Wannier function would roughly tell you where your electrons, where your valence electrons are located on average. So the workflow looked quite complicated, but in fact, it's not so. So many of these points are just included in step-by-step when you run this script. So the first, you begin with the regular self-consistent field cycle in the WIEN2k. And you have to produce a band structure plot. Then we move to the WIEN2Wannier and do some initialization, which involves a couple of steps where you choose what are the bands and what involved in Wannierization and what is the number of the Wannier functions that you would like to compute. And you set up the initial projection, so you will like to choose what you want to do is going to be sp3, or do you want to get some d electrons in the picture? So that's set up at that point. So then you run the W to W. This computes the overlap matrix element, the initial projections. And then the external package, the Wannier 90, is run to perform the Wannierization. So as a result, you obtain some output files that will be interesting for the analysis, in particular this file that shows you the Wannier Hamiltonian. You can also then go back to the WIEN2Wannier package and you can run a couple of commands that help you to visualize the Wannier functions, and you can eventually perform visualization with the xcrisden and plot your Wannier functions. Because when you perform the Wannierization, you don't really see how they look like. You cannot tell are they S-like or they're P-like, or you can tell only about position of the Wannier functions, but the shape can remain hidden from you. So this is an example of the output of the Wannier calculations. This is the file I was talking before, HR dot. So this is the position in three-dimensional space. So if you remember, 000 refers to the home unit cell. And if you see 001, this is the next cell in Z direction shifted. So these next two columns refer to the Wannier functions, and this value is the matrix element. So if this is the matrix element between the Wannier function S1 and S2, so you see here, this is refers to the S2, and this is referred to S1. How do I know that this is S and not P? So I have to visualize them and before I can really tell this exactly. So in this calculation, what has been done, there were four Wannier functions were set at each individual atom. There's two atoms in this calculation and total eight Wannier functions. So it was sp3 type of bonding. So you can see that the projection, this matrix element of the Wannier function on itself in the home unit cell is just the energy level of the SE. So this energy level of the S electron at the first atom. So this would be the overlap matrix element between the S electron on the first atom and the S electron on the second atom in electron volts. And this actually tells you about the strengths of this chemical bonding between different atoms. So it's something similar to what Peter described previously when we looked at the fat bands and the density of states, but you can get a much more quantitative description of your system when you do it this way. So you can also see that the Wannier functions are well localized here. For example, the same Wannier function on the next unit cell, the overlap is not very high. That means there's like interaction not between nearest neighbor atoms, but far neighbors is not very high. So this kind of brings us to the so-called tie bonding description of the Hamiltonian. So as a part of the analysis of the Wannier functions, we construct or compute eventually the band structure. So in that case, it was the gallium arsenide band structure, and you select for the Wannierization, you select a certain range of energy, certain bands, and you can see these red points are the density functional calculations, and the line that is going through them, this green line, is the calculations using the Hamiltonian of the Wannier functions. And you can see it fits really, really nicely all your data. So the advantage here is that to get all these red points, you spend quite a lot of time to get all the green points. It costs you nothing because the Hamiltonian constructed here, it is very easy to evaluate and very easy to compute. So there are orders of magnitude difference in terms of the computational time. So where that can be useful later is, for example, if you'd like to construct a supercell. If you want to make a really large supercell and you find out all these interaction parameters, you can parse them together and you can make a tie bonding calculation that is as accurate as a density functional calculation, but at a very little fraction of cost of this calculation. So you can go to thousands of atoms without losing the accuracy of the DFT. So this sounds very attractive. I should mention also the disentanglement, because sometimes, like in this case, we didn't have any problems. So all the bands of our interest were, so to say, there was no conflict with other bands here. Like you see, this is the S band at the bottom, just stays on its own. But here, in the case of a gallium nitride, the D electrons of the gallium that kind of interfere with the S electrons of the nitrogen. So if you'd like to do the same thing, the sp3 Wannier basis, in that case you have to disentangle these electrons, and there's some procedure related to that. So you have to select more bands, and then the Wannier algorithm would decide which of these bands are relevant, which are irrelevant, but you have to guide this process yourself, telling which energy windows you'd like to fit perfectly, which energy windows you kind of leave alone on for the Wannier 90 code to decide. So that is a little bit more involving in terms of tuning the parameters, but eventually you can get it work. So now I'd like to get back to the so-called bond-centered Wannier functions and their relations to the polarization. In this case, you see two examples, a silicon and a gallium arsenide. So in the case of silicon, the bond-centered Wannier functions, so now the difference is not like sp3 hybridization, so we have only valence electrons, and we see the Wannier function that are indicating a position of your valence electrons, and we see here that the Wannier function is positioned right perfectly in the middle of the bond between the two silicon atoms, indicating that there is no preference for the electron to be on one atom or on another silicon atom. However, if you look at this case, so you see gallium and arsenic, there's like a center of mass of the Wannier function is shifted toward the arsenic. So this is indication of the fact that the arsenic is actually attracting more valence electrons than the gallium. So they're shifted toward arsenic. And you can maybe schematically plot it this way. This minus is the position of the Wannier center, and the plus would be position of the ions of the arsenic and the gallium. And using this information, the position of the ions and position of the Wannier centers, it is possible to compute the polarization in this material. And that brings me actually to the second part of this presentation. It is the polarization and the related properties. So is there any questions to the first part? Yes?
Some of this ordinary function R of
I. Yes.
They replace the function inside the T sphere?
Yes, so the there's no direct relation to the RMT, so they can go outside of the RMT spheres, so they don't have to be confined within the spheres, unlike the core electrons in the WIEN2k calculations. So there's no requirement for the confinement. For example, in that case, the Wannier function can be right between the two atoms, so it will the center will actually be located outside probably of the spheres.
For
extended electrons? Well, you can use it for the extended electrons. It's a similar idea to the tie bonding picture or atomic orbitals picture. So you bring atomic orbitals or two atoms and they have sp and three orbitals. They start interacting with each other. Before you bring them close enough so that they interact, they are truly localized. But after you bring them and you allow them to interact, so this localization breaks and your states becomes, they will be partly sitting on one atom and partly sitting on another atom. You'll get dispersion and you'll get a band structure eventually. So the having this localized basis does not mean that the final result of the interaction between these Wannier functions had to be localized as well, but the Wannier functions will be localized. Yes? Next? What is S and what is P? What is P?
How do I do it?
Okay. So we have to look at the Wannier function. We have to actually plot first, second, third, then we see what is their character. So if we see this, we know it is the S-like. And if we see something like this, you see the two lobes and they have a different phase, plus and minus. This is going to be a P-like. So I'll plot them before I go into this interpretation. And then I know my Wannier function number one is S-like. Then this 2, 3, 4 are P-like, so it'd be PX, PY, PZ. And then the next ones are sitting on another atom. And I again start with S, and then PX, PY, PZ, the Wannier function sitting on the other atoms. But looking at this table, you can't really tell whether they are S or P-like until you do visualization of them. Yeah. But in this table, you can see, for example, that the P orbitals are orthogonal to S orbitals because there's no matrix element here. And this is a good news for us. That's how it's supposed to be. And there was some cross-check as well. This? This one? It's just numerical noise. But it's we can consider it quite orthogonal. Yeah. So sometimes what happens, if the center shifts a little bit from the atom, then you will see these numbers are not absolutely zero. And this is one of the things that you can't really nail these Wannier functions in space. So the code, the Wannier 90 code, would decide what is the best fit for your system. And sometimes you want them to be on the atom city, but then they drift away and they're like, oh, what I can do, bring back, no. They're gone. There's some extensions of this code, which of the Wannier 90 like flavors, which allow some symmetry, fixed symmetry, some, you know, more constrained Wannier function calculations, but not the Wannier 90 code. However, my experience shows that if you set it up correctly, you get you can get a good results. However, it is probably a case where you should know about your system way more than in the, say, regular calculation, because it requires, you know, you have to know which bands, you have to know which orbitals to put on them, you have to know what the range should be. So it needs some preliminary knowledge of the system, so it probably goes through fat band analysis in order to gain more insight of the system before you proceed with the Wannier function calculation. So like going blindly into Wannier functions is not probably the best idea. Yeah. Yes.
We showed the comparison of DFT and time binding with other mass
types.
Mm-hmm. So, one was the speed of interaction, the second one was the band gap. Can we use the
MBG functional? Yeah, I think there's no problem about the MBG functional. So you get what, essentially, the best result, it's just you reproduce the bands. You can fit the MBG band, so you'd reproduce MBG bands. You can also do a spin orbit coupling, which I didn't show here, but you can add the spin orbit coupling. It is not a problem for the Wannier as well. Yeah. All right, so shall I move on? So there's some resources which is mostly for the reading in your free time. So the second part of this presentation, we're going to talk about the microscopic polarization. And again, we're going to use the WIEN2k, the WIEN2 Wannier, and BerryPi. So they're all part of the WIEN2k package. So in that case, you don't need to install something extra like Wannier 90. You don't need Wannier 90 for this analysis to perform. So everything is now packaged conveniently. You only need a Python and the NumPy libraries for that, and most of the computers or supercomputer centers would have that already configured and installed. So we'll begin with the polarization. I just would like to mention a few properties that are directly related to the microscopic polarization, such as the piezo and ferroelectricity, the dielectric screening, the effective charges in molecules and solids, and pyroelectricity. So we can ask ourselves, what is the polarization? And we take a look at this famous Feynman lectures on physics. And the tale tells us that the polarization is a dipole moment per unit volume that is represented by a vector P. So that makes a lot of sense, of course. We look at this water molecule. So the hydrogen atoms bear some positive charge because they give up an electrons or part of the electrons to the oxygen that bears negative charge. And if we know the position of the atoms and the magnitude of this charge Q that they exchange, we can compute the polarization vector, and they will point down in this case. However, if we look in a solid, periodic solid like this, we can choose a unit cell that would be represented by this white rectangle, and we can say that we have the polarization vector by analogy with this case pointing down. So this will be an atom that grabs electron from this atom that is shown with the positive charge and this with the negative charge. However, you can quickly see that this leads us to some problems. So if we decide to move a unit cell a little bit down, which is totally a valid construction from the periodical boundary condition. So you can see that now my polarization vector is actually the same magnitude, but points in a different direction. So that's kind of not a good idea. If you want to compute property, you can't even tell what the magnitude, you can't even tell what the direction is supposed to be. You can even shift this white unit cell right in the middle, which is fine as well, and then you'd realize that the polarization is actually zero in that case. Yeah. So that actually was a major problem that was resolved by King-Smith, Vanderbilt, and Rester, who proposed the so-called modern theory of polarization. So they said that you shouldn't be obsessive about the value of the polarization. What actually matters is the change in the polarization. So if we look in any observable properties, it is the change in the polarization that is measured experimentally rather than the polarization itself. So this is a very important message, and if you take this out home, just only that message from this talk, I think it will be a great result. Okay. So if we, for example, strain the crystal, there will be some change in the polarization, and our piezoelectric properties are related to the change in the polarization induced by the external perturbation in the form of strain. So the external perturbation in the case of screening, it is the external electric field. So we look how the polarization change when we apply an electric field. In the case when we talk about the effective charge, it is the change in the polarization when we displace atom in space. And for the ferroelectricity, it is change in the polarization that is induced by the change in the temperature. So as you can see, the absolute value of polarization doesn't really matter. It is what matters is the change in the polarization. So that actually tells us that in order to compute any polarization-related properties, we have to do at least two calculations. Yeah, so it is impossible to just run one calculation, read the polarization value, and say, oh, okay, I'm having like ferroelectric or something like this. So it is impossible. So there should be minimum two calculations done in order to compute delta P. So that is very important. So how do we compute polarization? There are two components to the polarization. One is the so-called the ionic component of the polarization, and it is the information about core charge and the nuclear charge of the ions in the calculation, and as well as all the electron clouds that are around go into the electronic component of the polarization. So the computation of the ionic component of the polarization is not difficult. So we just need to know the position of ions and their charge. So that is easy. The computation of the electronic component is a little bit more involving, but you already see these matrix elements and this matrix element that we have previously seen in the Wannier functions. And this matrix element are related to the position of the Wannier center. So basically what you do is you look at the position of the Wannier centers is where the density of the electron is in space. So we already talked about the phase. So this is the phase that we are computing, and this is a change in the phase between the two adjacent K points in the direction in which the polarization is measured. So we can compute the polarization in three different directions, x, y, z. And what we do for this computation, we take, we measure the difference in the phase between the two adjacent k points. So we compute this matrix element. And then you look at the difference and we add them together between these two points, these two points, these two points, and integrate this phase along the this direction, and this is the direction in which we would like to measure the polarization eventually. And we construct multiple of those K passes, those strings of the K passes, and we integrate that along the phase along those K passes. And then we average them out, and then you get the average phase, and from this average phase, we get the polarization at the end. So we add the electronic phase and the ionic phase together in order to compute the polarization. So the meaning of the phase is if you have, for example, one electron and it is located at the origin, the phase is zero. If this one electron is located right at this corner, so you move it by one lattice constant, the phase becomes 2 pi. So if it is in the middle, the electron, the phase is pi. Okay. So all these phases are measured in the units of pi. But you have many, many electrons in the system. It's not just one electron. There are hundreds of electrons. So your phase become very many times pi. So that causes some problems later, which we're going to talk about. So here I just wanted to show briefly how to, you know, what step involves in running the very pi calculation. So they're all automatic. So you just execute very pi minus k. This is important part. You have to tell what is the discretization in the k space you would like to have for these integrals to be evaluated. For the first starting point, it is maybe a good idea to choose the same k-mesh that you used in the self-consistency calculation, and then you can work with this later, see how it converges, your polarization value converges with this. You can also add some parameters to go for spin orbit calculation, spin polarized, or add the orbital potential. In the end, you're going to be you will be given the values of polarization and the tables. We'll see it later. So as I said, the typical workflow involves calculation of the two structures. In this case, for example, you would like to measure the spontaneous polarization in a perovskite structure. You would need to have a reference structure and your distorted structure. So the reference could be a cubic structure, and then you have a structure where you have ferroelectric distortion, and we measure a difference in polarization between them. It is not enough to just compute this structure and claim, oh, I have spontaneous polarization. As I said, there should be always two calculations, minimum two calculations run. As I mentioned before, we have many, many electrons, and for every electron, you have possible phases between 0 and 2 pi, depending on where the average position of that electron is in the space. So eventually, we have to bring them somehow onto this 2 pi circle. And that gives us some uncertainty because, for example, if you have the value of just slightly less than pi, this is your phase, and then you have another value of the phase in a calculation, say this was a reference calculation, this is the calculation after some distortion or perturbation, and you have this phase, then it's not quite certain whether you have to calculate the difference in the phases like this, which is going to be a big number about 2 pi value, or you should take that difference in the calculation and base your result out of that. So that can be resolved by performing some intermediate step calculations. So now I'd like to show you some demonstration on the calculation of the effective charge in gallium nitride. So for this calculation, we'll take the structure of the gallium nitride, which is the Wurzite structure. And the effective charge is related to the change in the polarization as a result of displacement of an atom. So what we're going to do, we take nitrogen and we will displace it from the perfect position, shift slightly up. And then we're going to measure the phase, electronic and ionic phase, before the shift and after the shift, calculate the difference in the phase, and then eventually calculate the effective charge using this so-called shortcut formula, which is okay to use, with not the full one, but the one that involves the phases and the change in the ionic position in fractional coordinates. And that works if you look in the same direction and there's no volume change or no change in the lattice constants. So for this calculation, so as I said, we always need two calculations. And I have two cases set up here. So I call it gallium nitride zero. The zero would be our reference structure, the perfectly optimized structure. So I go in this calculation. So there's structure file here. So all these parameters were previously optimized using LDA. And the position of the nitrogen atom is like that. So it is 3, 7, 6 fractional coordinates. So we can verify the structure is actually Wurzite, as we can see. It is hexagonal. We look from the top and you see this tetrahedral bonding. So this is a Wurzite structure. So we can do initialization of the calculation. So in that case, I used just 300 points in this calculation. So that resulted in the K-mesh of 8 by 8 by 4. And then we can run the self-consistency cycle using standard convergence parameters. Again, you are welcome to experiment with this value to see how that affects your final result. I'm not going to repeat it because it takes a little bit of time, and this is a standard thing that you have done it already. So the calculation is actually completed in this directory, so there's no need to repeat it again. So then I'm just doing berry pi minus k 884. So this is the k mesh that would correspond to my 300 k points. So this is the same mesh I used in the SCF calculation. So then I run berry pi. So it will print you some information about the location of your Python, the location of the berry pi, the version of it. So sometimes it is important. If we find some bugs or make some updates or add the features, there is a website on the GitHub where we have the most recent version posted. And if you would like to make an update, so you just go into your berry pi folder in the WIEN2k distribution, and there's a simple command that helps you to get a full update of your berry pi. So it is possible without waiting for, say, a next version of the WIEN2k that comes with the updated berry pi, you can update it yourself. So what it's doing and is spending most of the time in this LAP W1 calculation of the vector files, that is actually done on a full K mesh. So you don't get a reduced Brillouin zone, you get a full Brillouin zone. So therefore, be careful when you choose the K mesh. That can be quite time consuming, even for small cases. Once it is done, then you move to the WIEN2 Wannier calculation, and you see it chooses the block and the band ranges based on the occupancy of the bands. So one thing that is important to mention is that you have to perform these calculations for insulators. So the calculations for metals or metallic occupancy is not going to make any sense. So it should be an insulator. You should check your occupancy of the bands in your SCF file, and make sure that you have a full occupancy of the band. So it will be 2 in the case of non-spin polarized calculation, or 1 in the case of spin polarized calculation, and the other bands should be empty. And if you see fractional occupancies, that's going to be a problem. So sometimes we get a request that some results don't make sense, but then you look in the self-SCF cycle done before that, and you see that it is a metal, so that's not going to work. Okay, so these are results of the calculations. So you got this long table with the passes. These are the passes that I show you, those strings and the phases along these passes. So we can just look at one of them. You see this is the phase in radian, this is 2 pi, and then it is actually wrapped into almost a zero phase. So you see some phase you get on the path plus pi, sometimes plus 2 pi, sometimes minus 2 pi, sometimes zero. So they all have to be wrapped to make a smooth, a continuous function. As you can see, the along the direction 1x, it is almost zero, and it is zero in this case, but there's some phase along the z direction. This is where we have a polarization in the gallium nitride. And we can see there's some values of the phases that we probably would like to record for our. So we have the ionic phase, and we have the electronic phase. So we have to write them down. So this is the value for the electronic phase. It's minus 0.1538. And the electronic phase should be somewhere here. Yes, total electronic phase is this value, ionic phase, 15080. So these are all values in radians. Then we can perform a similar calculation, but we change displace an atom. So I change the session and I go to another session where I have a structure slightly modified. So if you remember, there was 376. So I put here 377. And adjusted that value accordingly. So we shift by 1,000 of the fractional coordinate just these nitrogen atoms, and now perform the same initialization and the self-consistency calculation using the same parameters, and then we can perform the Berry pi calculation. Again, we have to be consistent with the choice of the K-mesh and other parameters. So while the calculation is running, I would like to make some comments about this structure file. So in these two calculations, because the idea is to keep them as close as possible. So if you use one RK-max in one calculation, use the same RK-max in another. If the number of K-points shouldn't change as well. So you should keep them as consistent as possible, including the symmetry of the calculation. So if you have some more symmetric structure, for example, in the case of the cubic perovskites, so don't start with the symmetric structure, because then you make displacement, your structure becomes asymmetric, so you lose a lot of the symmetry of the cubic structure. So start with the least symmetric structure, your calculations, and then when this is done, then you just bring your atoms into more symmetric positions and do some tricks, which we can discuss during the tutorials, in order to keep that low symmetry, not get WIEN2k realize that your new structure is now cubic and doesn't have these ferroelectric distortions. So this way, this number of symmetry operations the same at two calculations becomes identical. So the point to do this is that these changes in the polarization are very tiny, so you measure little differences, and any changes in your calculation may impact this result. So you see here, we already gone through the LAP W1, and we are at the another step. It is the WIEN2k calculation. So it calculates these matrix elements that are later used to evaluate the phases along those strings. And we're going to be getting soon the results . Okay, so these are the results. So we got the ionic and the electronic phases. So this is the value for the, so this is our reference structure. So this will be distorted structure. So we get this value for the electronic, 0.2509, and then we look for the value for the ionic phase, 1, 4, 4, 5, 1, right? Okay. So now what we need to do, we have to add them. Have to add them together. Just let me exit this screen. Okay, so in order to compute the total phase, we have to add the ionic and electronic component together. And once we computed the total phases, we take a difference between the two calculations. So I have my cheat sheet already prepared, and here are the results for this calculation. I think that we get in the same number as here. So this is a total phase in the case 0. This is my reference case, and the total phase in the case 1. This is my distorted phase. As you can see, the results are not so super different as opposed to that, because the electron change in the electronic phase is somehow compensated by the change of the ionic phase. And this is a total change in the phase between this case and that case, and this is in radians. This is delta U, is our displacement in the fractional coordinates, and I punch the numbers into here in the calculation of the Z prime, and I have to take into account the number of atoms that were moved. You remember in the structure file we had two galliums and the two nitrogens, because they had equivalent position. So we shifted, technically we shifted them both together. So in that case, the two atoms were shifted. So we have to keep that in mind. And this is the this is our effective charge in the fraction of the elementary charge. This is the value. So why is it negative? Because the nitrogen is electronegative, so it attracts electrons from the gallium. So the valence of nitrogen is 3. So you see, we get quite close to this value. And these are this so-called reality check. So you look at the literature values, and this is the results that are measured from the LOTO phonon splittings. It's 273, and this is our value. You see, without much of an effort, we even didn't go into some crazy convergence or anything like that. So we got a very decent result for the effective charge. So it's quite nice and powerful tool. Again, some reading your free time, and would like to thank to the developers of the Berry Pi. We had a whole team of people, and including Sheikh Jamil Ahmed, who is right in the room. So you have questions, here we go. And I'd like to also thank to the WIEN2k Wannier developers, because we were in contact with them very often to make sure that our interfaces are compatible and work together. And also would like to thank to funding agencies for supporting this project. Thank you for your attention, and we have a few minutes for questions.